My name is Lori. I'm almost 50. I had a stroke in 2020. When I had my stroke,
yeah.
I actually didn't know that I'd had a stroke that instant. It was in the morning, happened to be a day off of my work. I got up to go to the bathroom. For some reason, I couldn't get up to go to the bathroom. And then when I could get up, I ended up getting my son to tell him I wasn't feeling well. Apparently, he took one look at me and was like, oh, yeah, let's go. I wasn't at the hospital very long, and the neurologist came to get me, actually, and she said, yeah, you've had a stroke, we're keeping you. It felt long, because it was during COVID, so of course, when I was in the hospital, I couldn't believe they only kept me 9 days. And then they sent me home, but I think there's more, because they needed the beds. A lot of it was they had to set me up for the outpatient rehab at the hospital, and then they had to set me up to do stuff at home, because I couldn't do a lot of it there, because of COVID. And then I was just going to get tested to see how far I was going. I was pretty busy. I worked a lot. I'm a single parent, so I did a lot of things at home, for my kids and stuff like that too, and that type of thing. And heading my youngest into her final years of high school. So I've lived in Victoria area my whole life. So yeah, and I was working before. I had just switched jobs actually. I was at my new job, probably not even 6 weeks, and I had my stroke. I got connected to VBIS from the outpatient rehab at Victoria General Hospital because it was the next step to going to them. So you were the outside portion of what they do, I guess. So it's my getting together with people because I don't get together with like family members or friends outside of, because they're all busy. They all have their lives from before. I get frustrated a lot easier. I used to have a lot more patience than I do now. I have no patience now in comparison. I don't get out and do things like I used to be able to do. And so a lot of my recovery was within the complex that I lived in. So, you know, because I didn't have the equipment at home, nor did I have a space big enough to bring equipment in. So we all did what I needed to do. So I just get used to walking around in the complex and things like that. And I don't think a lot of people really want to hang out with me as much as they used to because they don't understand. They thought that I should go back to the way I was. That's what a lot of people think, right? You go back to where you were, it's like, it doesn't work that way. Just because I was sent home after 9 days in the hospital doesn't mean I was cured and I should be able to go do anything. That getting them to realize that it's very, like not being able to do as much as I did in my day, like it's much more tiring because the brain's tiring down. As the person who has the injury, it's hard to realize that as well, but getting other people to realize that, you know, just because I'm at home doesn't mean that I'm doing nothing. I have to do certain amounts of things, pace it out, you know. If they'd known about brain injury altogether, I think people just need to know more. Like, just need to know more that it's still there. Just because somebody looks fine doesn't necessarily mean that they are. Like, I have to physically, verbally remind people or tell people, like, this, I am not able to do where I don't have this part of, you know, this part of my brain is not working properly to have me do that. But I think more with when people more understand it. Like I have a lot of, I used to work at places that had like diversity, but now that I had a brain injury, they don't have diversity. They just know how to work with somebody that is in a wheelchair or providing handicapped parking spaces. They don't know how to deal with somebody that's got a brain injury. They would just think that they'd be difficult. And I've worked in those situations and had that training, and I could tell you that the training for people with brain injuries is not there. And it should be. People don't acknowledge a brain, they don't acknowledge a brain injury. So unless they actually see something, they don't. They just think you're being difficult. Difficult doesn't necessarily mean being difficult. Difficult by what society thinks is difficult isn't a brain injury, right? I hope that there would be more education in brain injury so that it makes it a lot easier in the future for people, you know, and that people realize that you're not the same before as you were before. I think most people just need to realize that everybody with brain injury are not the same. Like, everybody's brain injury isn't going to be the same, so they're not going to get better the same. They're not going to be like they were before. You know, your family members, friends, people that know you or don't know you, just, you know, the ones that know you or are your friends, but just realize that it's going to be a new you, and they're going to have to adjust to the new you and just the same as you are.
Hi, my name is Jordan. I'm 36 and I had a concussion in 2017. It was a hockey game where me and another guy were just skating after a loose puck. We were both going in opposite directions and both going full speed, and it was just an accident. We both turned the wrong way to get out of the way, and it was kind of a yard sale. I was trying to change my career. I wanted to be a firefighter. I actually almost didn't play the hockey game. Posting a competition for a firefighter position at a couple of the fire departments in town here, and past the written test phase, the next step was the ride-along phase, and that would have been coming up in the next week or two. I wanted to be in good shape for that, so I thought, should I play the hockey game? I might get injured. I wasn't thinking concussion. I was thinking, you know, I don't want to hurt myself and miss the ride-along. So, but ultimately I decided, okay, well, no, I'll just do what I've been doing that got me here, and that was playing the hockey game, and it just happened to be the night. At the time, I didn't think that anything had really, like, I knew what a concussion had felt like from before, but I felt okay kind of at the time. I did a little self-check. I knew what day it was, where I was, and all that, so I was like, oh, I'll play the rest of the game. And it wasn't until after where I realized I was, like, super confused. I went to the penalty box instead of the player's bench to collect some of my stuff, and then I was like, okay, something's going on. My head felt bigger than it was big enough for. But then, you know, if I pushed it, I tried to work for about a week and a half after, and the screen time really affected me. So I was having a really hard time focusing. One eye would focus kind of near, one far, and it was really hard to strain them to bring them together. The one that was kind of the most relieving to kick was probably like the sea legs or dizziness feeling. It's not vertigo where the world is spinning, but just that feeling like when you've been on the boat all day and you hit land for the first time. Life was full. It was a big life. I didn't realize how big at the time, but we had a three-year-old at home, and I was volunteering at our fire hall, had a full-time job, and just tried to stay really active. For the first three to four weeks, I did nothing but try and like rest to heal myself. I totally mismanaged the concussion. From previous concussions, that's how I dealt with them. And there's so much more now where you can rehab certain symptoms. There was like a 4 to 6 week wait time to get in with a sports medicine guy who referred me to my physio. And eventually you can kind of bring it all together, and it got to the point where I was able to kind of mimic a work day at the library, like a partial work day, and then get back to the office about 9 months after. Yeah, it was tough. There was a few times where I'd go to the store, like it was my kid's birthday, and I went to go pick out a baseball glove for him and pick up a cake on the way home. Like 10 minutes at sport check, and like the walls started to move, and I had a headache the rest of the day. Like I was spent by the time I got home from that for the rest of the day, and it kind of ruined being able to be like present for his birthday. I was there, but you know, it was a rough night. It wasn't good. Things like that made it pretty tough through the recovery phase. I think that's one of the hardest things to get over, is this person that you used to be, and you think, I should hit that bar. And in order to hit that bar, I have to do X, Y, and Z every day. And it just, you end up spinning your tires. I think the most challenging part was home life. You know, you develop a certain dynamic in your relationship with your wife, and you have family responsibilities and home life, work life, you know, volunteer fire hall. You have expectations of yourself, people have expectations of you, and just the feeling that you're constantly letting people down all the time. I think that's probably the hardest thing to get over. Working with those people that are close to you to kind of reframe those expectations over time, to try to get to a point where you can both kind of accept, move on, and kind of enjoy the new. Things are a little smaller now. It's less about an ambition to change my career or you know, fill the calendar with rec activities. You kind of appreciate the littler things more, like going for a walk. I used to hate going for walks. It was like, I'd go for the walks for the dogs, but that'd be about it. And now we enjoy going for walks all the time. The doctor's like, you really should follow up with the Brain Injury Society. They may not be able to like find out and diagnose any new problems, but you can certainly meet a lot of people that you relate with and develop some coping skills. And I would say that's exactly what it's been good for. I have reframed a little bit from, okay, instead of chasing down an answer and trying to fix myself, just acceptance, coming to a place of acceptance. This is the way I am now. And, you know, what are other people doing that can help, you know? And the courses that VBIS puts on, they've been informative. And then I think as much as they are informative, they're just peer support. And you get so much out of talking to people who are going through. You can't relate to everybody because, you know, all sorts of people come from different brain injuries and they're dealing with different things. It's been good to meet lots of people who are going through similar type things and struggling with similar type things. You can pick up tips and tricks off of them and, you know, just a sense of togetherness, I guess. You know, you're not in it alone. you meet somebody out there who's struggling with similar stuff. There's more than just your symptoms, and there's still what can give a lot of people hope is that, yeah, you may have lost, like for example, the fire hall. I went back in there like months later and I went for a coffee with the guys, and I remember it wasn't until getting down to the apparatus bay, we opened up the door and the smell of like diesel and the equipment, just the smell triggered this like instant like tears, just reaction coming down my face at something I'd lost, right? But instead of identifying with those things that you used to do, you get to kind of frame it however you want, and you can pick up new things, and I have, and it's been really rewarding.
My name is Michael. Born and raised here in Victoria, I sustained an injury in March of 2019 by way of an ischemic hypoxic injury. I suffered that as a result of a suicide attempt through using carbon monoxide poisoning. I left Victoria in around 1981 or so and started my little journey around the world. Worked on cruise ships, spent time up in Alaska, all sorts of fun stuff. And then went to school again, got my education on my diplomas in real estate and finance. Ended up all over the place, ended up out in Halifax where I spent the last 20, prior to my injury, it was 20 years in Halifax. Met a girl, fell in love, got married for the first time. And that unfortunately didn't work out. But I was woken up on the garage floor, taken to the ICU, put in a hyperbaric chamber overnight, intubated, respirator, doped up. I had both lethal and toxic levels of carbon monoxide in my system of just shy of 40% of my blood was not able to carry oxygen. And I didn't really expect to wake up. I woke up the next morning in the ICU. The last thing I remember was pouring more gasoline into my snowblower. I had my snowblower, my motorcycle, and my generator going in the garage. Was released into the care of my wife and her brother, who, when we got home, decided that suicide was something they couldn't handle, and I got kicked out of my house that morning, like 12 hours after getting out of the hospital. I was given a couple of hours to pack my suitcase. And that obviously caused quite a bit of chaos, quite a bit of confusion, because I was out, didn't know what the hell was going on. My sister and my mother intervened, and apparently this had, there had been some plans around a certain day, because my wife presented me with a separation agreement a few hours after getting out of the hospital, expected me to sign it. And when my family heard that, they panicked. They said, "What the hell? Something's..." So they just said, "Get him out of Halifax and back to Victoria now." So that afternoon, I got on a plane, apparently. flew from Halifax to Victoria, 11 hours with changes and stuff. Landed here. Remember thinking, what am I doing in California? It's so warm here. And I was like, and it was one of those, like you wake up from a dream and you're kind of like, who the hell am I? And I had two suitcases, and that's what I started here with, was two suitcases 3 years ago. Brain injury and mental health are tied together. Oftentimes, there's the correlation between the two sometimes is quite distinct. If not before the injury, definitely after the injury. Because trying to cope with a new reality using a broken guideline to interpret a complex world, where the signaling and the return signaling, the feedback signaling, may not be working anymore. And what that does is it creates a lot of fear, creates a lot of frustration. And fear was huge, because my system would crash, and you know, my eyesight would start to go, I'd start to get shaky, I'd have difficulty breathing. It was like the same sensation as when I was in the garage. It's like you can feel it and see it kind of going down. And for the first couple of year, or the first year and a half or so, had no idea where it was going. Had no idea how far down it was going to go. And that ended me in the hospital a few times, because it, friends and neighbors and everything called ambulances for me when I would pass out. The biggest challenge has been a frustration of not knowing what is going on, not understanding why I have to sleep for 2 or 3 days sometimes, understanding how difficult the stimulus can be is probably the big thing. For me, the big ones are sound and sight. When I walk outside, I'm always wearing sunglasses, and I always have earbuds to protect me from cars going by. Understanding the impact of the stimulus, light, sound, movement, noise, food, energy, sleep, you name it, whatever, memories, social events, obligations, work, anything that causes the brain to activate. And it gets processed somewhere in this gray matter, and it creates a response, always. And that response is what the world judges us by. One thing that I'm a firm believer in is what I call angels. I had an angel fly into my life, a lady who I hadn't seen in 35 years, my cousin. She comes in out of the blue, calls me up one day and says, "I want to take you for coffee." She sits me down, and you have to know this lady, she's just wonderful. She just stares at me and she goes, you have a brain injury. I'm taking you to VBIS. I just kept cutting things out of my life until I got it down to a manageable point so I could start to build. And now I want to start slowly bringing stuff back into my world. And VBIS plays a huge role in that, because it creates community. It creates community for me to get out into the world, talk with other people, and actually have interactions with them in a safe, accepting, understanding way. Folks at VBIS understand what's going on behind the eyes. They understand the history, they understand the challenges, and they understand that sometimes this is just a presentation. It's just like, I may present like things are wonderful, and 2 minutes later the door closes and they crash and crazy.
Hello, my name is Tony King, and I am 57 years old. I had an aneurysm, actually, and I had that in 2009. It has totally changed my life. When I first had my aneurysm, I don't remember a whole lot. It was the night of my 45th birthday. A very bad headache when I went to bed, and I don't remember much after that. My partner was telling me that I actually got up from the bed and went and got the phone because it was in the kitchen. We had just moved into this place and it was in the kitchen. So I must have gotten the phone, took it back to the bedroom, dialed 911 and collapsed. When the paramedics got there, it was like 2 o'clock in the morning, I think. And everybody was asleep, so they were banging on the door, and my partner went and answered the door, and they said that somebody had called 911. She said no and sent them away. When she came back down the hall, she said she heard me breathing and it didn't sound right, so she went and got the paramedics again, and they came in. She rolled me over and I was laying on the phone. I ended up having to go to Vancouver and having a surgery. That's when they found out that it was an aneurysm, it was in the brainstem, and that affected my eyesight, it affected my cognitive ability, my short-term memory is awful. I can tell you what happened, you know, 20, 30 years ago, but I can't tell you what I did yesterday. And when I got home, I had a lot of pain. Chronic pain in my head and neck from all the surgeries that I had. I must have had 3 or 4 surgeries. And that was very hard on me, on my partner at the time, and my son. My son was 3 at the time. My wife couldn't do it anymore, so we became a statistic of brain injury, and my marriage ended. And it was... That was very, very hard, trying to get used to being by myself after we were married for, we were together for about 15 years, married for 12 or 13. It was very hard to try and figure out, what am I gonna do now? My wife and I and our son came up here in 2007. And before that, we were living in Texas. I was working as an operating room technician, and I was working in labor and delivery, and that's where I met my wife, was in labor and delivery, and so we were delivering babies, and it was awesome hearing a baby cry for the first time. What? So I had gone to school for that, so that's what I was doing before we came up here. Once we got up here, I had applied for all my visas and all that fun stuff to work, and I didn't get a chance to really start working. That's when I had my aneurysm. The most challenging has been when I had the aneurysm, it affected my eyesight and my balance. And that's where I'm having my biggest issues. I have to walk with sticks so I can make sure I don't fall over. My eyesight, I see double, I have a double vision thing going on right now. I've had a couple of surgeries for that, and I need to have another one. As far as my balance is concerned, yeah, I fall over, but I get back up, and life is good. I think, for me, the thing that would make make it easier is if when I disclose that I do have a brain injury, I try and let people know, look, I have a brain injury, and if you can slow down just a little bit when you're talking to me, that would be great. If you're going to try and explain something to me, just give me a second to process. Sometimes I do feel like I'm stupid, and people make me feel that way sometimes. I don't let it affect me as like I used to. My mental health suffered quite a bit, mostly because of the isolation, and then COVID hit, and that didn't help either. I've had to learn how to navigate this place that we live, this beautiful place that we live. It's been a very anxiety-ridden kind of journey. Every day it's a fight. It's not a huge fight, but it is a fight, trying to get through the day. What gives me hope is doing things like this, getting the word out. Working with VBIS has been the most rewarding thing for me. And talking with people and doing these interviews and just getting the word out there that, yeah, we're here. And, you know, we're not stupid. We're not crazy. We're just trying to get a little help.
Ernano Angelazzi. I got my brain injury when I was 29, so that's 30 years. I fell off a second story balcony in April in Montreal. Fortunately, it was a warm spring, or I would have broken my neck on the frozen ground. I woke up a month later in intensive care at the Montreal General Hospital. They have one of the best institutes in the world, the Montreal Neurological Institute, which eventually I spent some time at because I had some seizure problems as a result of my fall. It was actually at night, a friend who lived a couple of blocks away called me over, another musician. We jammed for a little while. I had one glass of wine at his place. Then we walked about 20 minutes to a downtown bar. We had a couple of beers there. Walked back to my place. I was saying goodbye to him. I was up on my balcony, and I don't know. It was a bit slippery, and somehow I lost my balance and flipped over the balcony and headed for the ground. And I don't remember hitting the ground. Sometimes the brain blocks out traumatic incidents. You know? And when I woke up, everything was different. And of course, never expected this to happen. You know? But it also taught me that expect the unexpected, because once in a while it comes knocking on your door. Life was pretty good. I finished my BA with a major in psychology. And before doing my master's, I have an interest in music, rock and roll in particular, and I decided I'd take some time off and formed a band with some other people, and we did some gigs around Montreal and a few towns that were nearby. That was a lot of fun. And I was also changing the faces of billboards part-time. So, and I never once fell from any of the structures I was on, but we were very careful. As I don't know, as the catwalks this wide, and you've got to, you know, attach yourself, or because if you take a wrong step, you're going down, and it won't be a brain injury, it'll be death. Well, initially I was very angry, but I mean, you know, all the good you do goes back out into the universe and comes back, maybe not eventually in your own time, not like John Lennon's instant karma or anything. And all the bad as well goes out there and comes back into the world. So adopting that sort of philosophy, and I learned to meditate and do a few things to calm my temper down, because it used to rise really fast. But my friends always had to keep an eye on me if we went out and we had a couple of beers or something, because you know, if someone sort of was a bit too forward with me, I'd push right back. Sometimes I wouldn't even push, I'd just punch. I got over my temper problems, and that was part of the battle for me too, is regaining emotional control. Because I think that's something a lot of people lose after they have an injury, and it's a real fight to get it back. Things went really slow in the beginning. I had to learn to sort of formulate language again. I could think it, but speaking it was difficult. I wasn't pronouncing my words clearly. I mean, I had to learn to tie my shoes, put on my own clothes, all these things that I'd learned when I was a kid. I mean, I had to relearn. And also playing guitar. I mean, I had some muscle memory, but not playing for a year or more. I mean, I had to fight to get that back, and I had to do it slowly. And then when I got frustrated, I just turn up the amp real loud and just make feedback noises. But but that was a good way to get some anger out there. I was lucky that I had some really good friends, and my family stuck by me, and even some of them didn't understand, but at least, like my mother, I don't think she quite understands what I was going through, but she decided that she loves me anyway, so, you know, it's nice to have that sort of unconditional love. A lot of people don't get it. There's kind of like life before brain injury, and that life will never, my life now will never be what it was, and I stopped expecting it to a long time ago. And I think that's a helpful thing. A lot of people that have an injury expect their life to be the way it was before, but in terms of multitasking and emotional control and follow through and all these aspects of mental and physical life, I mean, you gotta learn that things aren't gonna be the same. It doesn't mean you can't be happy. It doesn't mean you can't have activities. You gotta concentrate on small things. I mean, if you enjoy cooking, well, put some time into cooking. My youngest sister is a recreational therapist. Sorry, I've just had so many therapists in my life. And she's a recreational therapist, and quite a good one, actually. She was aware of this place, and after I'd moved in and found an apartment, which was easier to do 13 years ago than it is today, she brought me to this place, which was on Queen Street at the time. And I went in, and I met the people that were running it, and I registered, and they said, don't come back here next week because we won't be here. They were moving to this address. So I said, what, I just joined? You're throwing me out already? Usually people wait a bit before they do that. And so I came here, and I was... Leedy was in Pam's office. This office has changed around so much. She was my caseworker, and she was helping me with my person with disability application. And I come down, and we work an hour, and she could see that I was getting tired. She said, well, just go around the corner. There's a peer support room. Have a cup of coffee, and you might meet some people. The first few times I went in there, I hardly said a word. Then one guy came over, started talking to me. I found out there was a music program there, so I started bringing my guitar on another day for music, and I gradually got involved in various programs and met a community of people that you know, had something happen that was similar to myself, in some cases, more severe injuries and stuff. And then learned to become a peer supporter myself, and I find I get a lot out of giving back. I think a lot of people associate brain injury with psychological problems. There was one guy recently, we had one client that used to have a really responsible job, and now just it's a struggle for him to, you know, get his clothes on and have breakfast in the morning and do the simplest things. And he's the first time he came in, he was saying, you know, I almost wish that, you know, I'd lost a leg or something, because people see me, you know, he's a tall guy in really good shape and that, and they think I'm fine. He said, but I'm not. I have all kinds of difficulties. And we were telling him, you're not the first to tell us that, and, you know, things are really hard now, but, you know, they'll get better. I mean, to some degree, you'll never have your old life back, but, you know, you'll be more in control of your emotions. You'll find out what you still can do, what you like to do, what you, how you want to spend your time. I mean, your life isn't over, it's just your life has changed. I mean, things aren't going to be the same, but it doesn't mean they can't be good again. And convince the people of that is kind of our mission here at the Brain Injury Society.